Welcome to episode number 7. I'm Roots, your host. This is a special episode where I don't discuss a specific book, but instead I delve into dialogue and what makes good dialogue, both in books and in movies. Quick pre-show announcement, in the show notes I've included links to movies and book snippets that illustrate the different elements of dialogue that I'll be talking about. With that, enjoy. Characters in movies don't talk the way we talk in real life. Characters in books don't talk the way we talk in real life. As much as we'd like to think that good fictional dialogue is quote-unquote realistic, it is, in fact, not. Good dialogue has to do with sounding real and authentic and realistic, yes. But there are other things that make good dialogue good. And here are a few of those things. First of all, dialogue has to reveal something new every time, all the time. It should be building the story. It should have a purpose. In my opinion, dialogue is the most efficient way to build a story because you're touching a bunch of different parts of the story all at once, driving plot, revealing character, describing setting and time period, and revealing emotion and motivation. There is, of course, a balance to how much dialogue should say. Dialogue is supposed to tell us just enough. It must not be preachy. It must tell us about the character and be true to the character's nature. It must drive a story forward, but in an authentic way, in a natural way. Dialogue is not regular talking. It's much more efficient than that. It must always have a purpose, but that purpose should never show through in an unnatural way. And that's where the second element of good dialogue comes in. Dialogue has to be authentic. It doesn't have to be correct. In fact, being incorrect is often part of being authentic. Sentence fragments, dropped G's, bad grammar, incorrectly used words. That's great, as long as it's true to the character and it is purposeful. Authentic doesn't mean real, though. Realistic dialogue isn't necessarily good dialogue. In fact, it's usually not. Try recording yourself speaking, unscripted, and then listen back, paying attention to all the times you say or you repeat words, overuse words like and really, or restart sentences. Try listening to other people talking, and you'll find the same inefficient, fumbling banter. Movies and books would probably be double their length if writers wrote the way people actually spoke. Not to mention, they'd be boring as heck. So, to be a good writer of dialogue, you have to be a good listener, a good selective listener. Good writers hear what makes a conversation flow. They hear the things that convey and spark emotion, and they pay attention to the words that ring with meaning and weight. They hear tones and the way different words contribute to those tones. They notice the way words sound, sharp versus smooth, quiet versus loud. They filter out the useless words, the repetition, the fumbled analogies, the overused phrases. Unless, of course, those things directly contribute to the purpose of the conversation. Dialogue has to be concise. The best way to talk about the importance of being concise is to explain how awful the opposite of concise is. In the worst movies, and sometimes books, characters do this abominable thing. They give speeches, not in front of an audience at a podium, but in a regular crowd, in a regular conversation. They philosophize. They clarify their motivations in deliberate, exact language. They explain what's going on in an effort to keep the viewer or reader on track with the story. This is hard to do without sounding stilted. Dialogue for the sole purpose of explaining something to the reader or viewer is basically never good. Think that famous love monologue by Dr. Brand in Interstellar, which is a great movie, by the way, just a little bit preachy. In movies, the world and the characters don't exist the way they exist in books, where so much information gets relayed through the prose. In movies, most of what you know about the characters and a lot of what you know about the plot comes from what the characters say and how they say it. And good movies don't take for granted the power of dialogue. They don't abuse it and bore the audience with it. Dialogue must have a good sense of timing. The way it reads or sounds should feel seamless, not jumbled or irregular. That way, the audience can get easily into the flow of a conversation and start to hear that conversation in their own heads. Most of the time, emotion is revealed by timing. Fast-paced conversations full of short phrases and exclamation points could be an argument. A conversation full of big words and long sentences could be two good friends having a drink in a quiet sitting room. And now let me talk about those infamous adverbs. Adverbs, adjectives for verbs, words like quickly or angrily, can easily become overused. I just talked about pacing, and there's nothing better at breaking up the flow of dialogue than too many adverbs or overused verbs, even simple ones like he said, she said. Once a conversation gets into the groove, descriptions following quotes shouldn't be necessary. The words should say it all. Lastly, there is an element of surprise in good dialogue. When we are confronted with plot twists or new information, it's best if we hear it from the characters themselves. That's when we find surprises most surprising and most believable. So yes, dialogue must be purposeful and concise and authentic and all that. But it must also do the things that it's not expected to do. Tell the things that the audience is not expecting to hear. Let me leave you with this famous Alfred Hitchcock quote. A good story is life with the dull parts taken out. Fiction and fictional dialogue is fiction because the real version wouldn't be nearly as tasteful or concise or interesting. Speaking of dialogue, listen to me. This is not natural. I work really hard at making my script and my reading of that script sound natural, and I think I'm getting better at it. But whatever it is, it's not natural. I'm literally reading it word for word. And for podcasting, at least the sort of podcasting I do, that's what it takes. But here's your chance to critique my writing or my delivery or whatever. If you have feedback or suggestions, you can get to me on Twitter at RootsMac. That's Roots spelled R-O-O-T-Z. I'd also appreciate it if you visited iTunes and left me a rating there. You're an awesome person if and only if you do that. Until the next one, guys, peace.